morning, LPC. How's everybody doing? Good to see you guys. I want to take just a moment to say thank you for everything. We have felt so welcomed here in the Homestead area. It's just been a pleasure to just dive right in. I've met a whole bunch of you, learned a lot of names. We have a lot more to learn. We'll do that with God's help. And hopefully there will be a continuing of learning of names as new people come into this place and lives are transformed. And I've heard some of your stories, but I want to hear more stories, amen, about what God is doing and how he's changing hearts and the lives of people. So you can help be a part of that by bringing your friends. And what a great time of year to do that. It's a special time that people are just open. They're just open. Their hearts are open to receive something and say, maybe I'll do something. And we don't have to wait till January 1st to do our New Year's resolutions, right? We can have end of the year resolutions as well. And maybe you can have that to say, I'm gonna get my neighbor. I'm going to get my friends. I'm going to get my family and just share the love of Christ with them. So thank you guys for making us feel welcome and allowing us to be part of the family here at LPC. I don't know if you guys, thank you, praise God. I don't know if you guys have felt anything this week. I have. I asked you to read some scriptures last week. When we kind of dove into the book of Philippians, which is one of my favorite books and some of my favorite verses, and we talked about expectation. And I don't know if you read that this week like I asked you. If not, you can go back and do that. Philippians 1, 20 and 21 are really the key verses there that we kind of honed in on last week. If you grab a hold of those and you begin to think about that expectation in your life and what God is doing, then you will start to feel that. And when we get together throughout the week, we come here, and when we get together and we come here, it's like a vitamin shot. You know what I mean? Some of you come dragging into church. You're just like, oh, I'm not going to make it. And let me tell you, you don't have to live like that. Now, it's nice. Some weeks, it just gets you. Some weeks just suck every bit of energy out of you. You know, you might have come out of Sunday and the Holy Spirit has just touched your life and you feel fuller than ever before, and then you walk out and you run into somebody and it just drains right out, right? You know those people. That's why you're laughing. You know those people. It used to be my sister for me, my middle sister. She'd get me. I'd have an amazing moment in church, walk out, look right at her. She'd say something, and man, wow, get me going for the week. Thanks, Lindy. She's probably going to watch this. I'll get a call later on this afternoon. But there's an expectation there that God is going to do something in our lives. And it's not just about us, but there's a hope. There's a hope that God has done something. And it's the hope of salvation, that there is transformation, that everything is different because of his love. And you should be able to feel that. That should be a charge to you. That means tomorrow morning when you wake up and you go, oh, it's Monday. Instead, you go, man, it's Monday. I get to do something. I get to share the love of Christ this week. I get to walk into the office and look at the guy in the cubicle next to me who's a, what are you so happy about? Well, I'm glad you ask. And you begin to tell him at that moment about what God has done and how he's changing your life. Man, there's a charge. There's a charge there. And we better, no matter what the situation is, expect that Christ would shine through us. I said it last week. I want you guys to be thinking about that, not just this year, but every single day of your life that you wake up, that you would expect God to do amazing things through you. There's something special about every one of you, and he wants to do wonderful things through you in every way. And if we talked about that verse, for me to live is Christ, for me to die is gain, either way, with Christ we win. Amen. It doesn't matter. You take me from this earth, man, I'll just go home and be with Jesus. You know what I mean? You leave me here on the earth, it's awesome. Let's do it. Let's do it with Christ here. So we're gonna go that way. And if you got your Bibles today, I want you to jump over to the book of Ephesians. Ephesians is a strong book. It's got things of the deep in it. I'm also going to be in Matthew today, so I want you to, if you've got your pen handy, you can make some notes. If you've got your tablets, whatever, you can maybe get to both places pretty quickly. But while you're turning there in the book of Ephesians, we have to understand that this life can be purposeful, and it can be fruitful, and that everyone here in this room has work to do. If you're retired, if you've been retired for 20 years, you have work to do. Everybody, put your fingers right on the side of your neck right there. Right there on your right side. Just hold it there. You feel that? You know what that is? It's a pulse. Yes, it's a pulse. That means there's blood pumping through your body. That means you're alive. And if you're alive, that means you have work to do. And God is doing something. So every morning, sometimes you might need to put your fingers on there. You might need to put your finger. Am I still alive? Yes, I am. That means that I need to kick in gear, and God needs to just show me what I want to do, and I just need to do that. But there's potential. There's potential in every single one of us. Now, you may sit back and go, I don't know if there's any potential in me. Now, listen, it may be latent. It may be lying dormant in there because you haven't tapped into it a while. But there is potential in every single person, in every single individual in there. And it's this potential that blossoms into something that God wants to do that becomes fruitful and purposeful in our lives. And that right there will change the world. And every single person in here is called to be a world changer. And Paul was a passionate man. The Apostle Paul, and he wrote to the Ephesian church, and he was very passionate before Christ, right? He had a plan, he thought he knew everything, and he was going forward with such drive and pursuit of what he thought was right, and he needed God to straighten him out. Now, when God straightened him out, did he lose all of his drive and passion? No, it just shifted. And some of you had been on a path for a very long time. You were heading this direction, and what you needed was God to go, get you right back on track, get you calibrated so you can move. Does he want you to lose that drive and that passion? No, he wants you to keep going. He wants you to intensify moving forward. Paul was that type of character. Now, you can spend all kinds of energy moving around and never get anywhere. Let me tell you, Homestead is confusing. I don't want to tell you how many times I've turned around in the last couple of weeks. Just about the time you think you got it, no. Pull up the GPS again. My phone battery's running low. It's just circling around. So a lot of times this week, I spent a lot of time circling around. At one point, I circled around and then realized I had circled around incorrectly and had to circle back around and go the way that I was going correctly. My wife said, "What are you doing?" I said, "I don't know. I don't know. Let's pull over here and pray that God will help us with this." But you can do that in your own life as well. You can sit here and spin in circles the rest of your life and never go forward. So it's not just about movement, but it's about momentum in the right direction. And God wants to turn your moment that we talked about last week. He wants to turn your moment into momentum. He wants to shift it, not to just, okay, I'm in this moment, but now what do I do with it? How can I grab and run? And God wants to turn our moment at LPC into momentum. Man, he just wants to shift. But there's something that you have to grab. There's something that you have to feel. You have to get that vitamin shot right inside of there. Now, Paul is writing to this church at Ephesus, and he's talking to them about the mystery of God's will in this part, and there's something there, and people go, well, the mystery of God's will, that sounds pretty deep. It is deep, but basically what he was saying is that everyone has access to the Father. Everyone. Everyone has access. You might look at somebody and go, they're just too far gone. Nobody is ever too far gone. Everyone has access. You might think that they're different than you. They might not connect with you. Everyone has access, and it's up to you to share with them. And this Ephesians that we're reading about helps us understand the church and its role, the church as a body. The church is a body that helps carry out the mission of Jesus, and the church as a family that where love is expressed and that we help each other grow in Christ and go forward. You feel that when you come in this place? I have never not felt that when I came in this place. I felt it when I walked into the Napa building last time. I walked in there and I said, "This is a family. I'm part of the family." I was pastoring another church, I felt like that. Now, I didn't know that then, but once again, I think that was all preparation, that God was stirring my heart for this time. That's how we have to look at it. But also, not just a body, not just a family, but also as a holy temple. The church has a holy temple, and what that means is we are called to holiness, church. That means when you come to Christ, the closer you get to Him, the more of this world should be falling off you. Say, I don't want to do that anymore. I'm not feeling that thing anymore. I don't have a desire for that thing anymore. I start moving closer to God, that stuff just drips off me. I'm not holding on to that anymore as I go towards Christ. And listen, when you're going to climb the mountain, Will Reagan says, I'll climb this mountain with my arms wide open. I will climb this mountain with my arms wide open. You can, with your arms wide open like this, I can't hold on to much. I can't. And I'm going after Jesus. And when I get to Him, I just hold on with everything I've got. But if we're hanging on to the things of this world, like this pulpit, and hanging on to this and hanging on to that, it's just hard to get a hold of something or somebody. Ephesians chapter 3, let's get there. Picking up in verse 14, he says, "For this reason I bow my knees before the Father." What a great position, right? What a great physical position that we would bow our knees. Some of you have grown up in a liturgical community where you actually get down on your knees. I say we all should be in that community where we're on our knees praying and diving into the presence of God. "For this very reason, I bow my knees before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and earth is named, that according to the riches of his glory, he may grant you to be strengthened with power through his Spirit in your inner being." Now listen, "so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may have strength to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and the length and the height and the depth, and to know that the love of Christ that surpasses all knowledge, and you may be filled with all the fullness of God." Whew. Now listen, I told you, these are the deep things. This is the big boy pool right here. We're going to talk about the deep things of God and the fullness of God and being holy and being changed and being transformed. This isn't the splash pad. This is the deep things. But I think you guys want that. I think we want to go there. But it's not just these things alone that we need to dwell on. Because look, here we go. Verse 20. If you got your highlighter, if you got something, you want to get these down. "Now to him who is able to do far more abundantly than all we ask or think, according to the power at work within us, to him be the glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen." To him be the glory. We. Look at that right there, right in the middle of verse 20. It says, "we ask." That's all of us. That's plural. That brings us together. We're a community of faith. We come in here, we're a family, so we ask. What are we asking? What are we asking? Because today we're talking more about the outside of LPC than we are LPC. Yes, that's part of it. We're not just talking about the church or RLBC, but what God does through us and what he wants to do through you because you're part of the family and how he wants to take you. So what we're thinking and what we're asking are important questions. You ever ask your kids, "What were you thinking? What was going on in your mind when you decided to do that?" I know I've been asked that by my dad. I've asked my daughter that. My wife has asked me that. It happens. What were you thinking? What was going on in this head of yours? Or maybe you've asked somebody a question, you know, about something, and they say, "I haven't thought about it." So I begin to ask you today, what's God stirring in your heart? Maybe this is a question for the year as we begin to carry on. We start looking at each other in the eye when we meet each other, not just on Sundays and Wednesdays, but when we get together in fellowship. Say, "Listen, what's God saying to you?" When somebody asks you that question, you better be ready, right? You know, what's been God saying to you? "I don't know." That's not a good response. You know what I mean? But as we dive into his word and we begin to highlight, and he begins to highlight things in our heart, and the words jump off the page, and somebody says, "What God's saying to you?" I said, "I'm glad you asked. Let me tell you what he's been telling me and what he's been showing me about my life and the life of my community and how we're supposed to do this thing." And you start acting like that, you start speaking like that, lives will be changed, I promise you. Bill Hybels is a great leader, one of the greatest church leaders of our generation, pastors Willow Creek Church in Chicago. Many, many years ago, he said that the local church is the hope of the world. Jesus did his work. We understand that, right? Jesus did. He's not coming back to die on a cross again. We understand that, right? It says, once and for all, he's not coming back to do it. He is coming back. But he's not coming back to die on a cross again. That is taken care of. So his plan to reach this area, his plan to reach this world is you and I and the church across the world. And so we have to grab that. We have to run. There's no plan B, people. There's no plan B. So if I begin to ask you these type of questions, what do you think God's saying to you? I mean, we know that Jesus is the hope of the world, obviously. But he's left us with the task of fulfilling. He's left us with the mission, but he's absolutely going to use us. And so I thank you. I thank you for being here. Not just today, but I thank you for being in this moment. The same moment we talked about last week. There's some, you've been set right inside of this. At this time, never before has it been like this. So what are you going to do? What's God saying to you? What does he want you to do? And the church has been called so much. And you might ask, what is the church? And obviously we know, seasoned believers know that the church is not these walls, right? We know that. You guys know this. This is elementary. You're the church. That's why you can walk into a room with a dirt floor in the middle of Africa or in China and begin to worship with the kindred spirit of people, because that's the church. It doesn't matter what building it is. We start pushing in like this, and the church has been called salt. It's been called light. It's been called a city on a hill that cannot be hidden. It's been called the pillar of the community, the flock, the sanctuary, the worship center, all of that. But it's not just this room filled with people. But it's these people living with real hope, reaching out to a very, very dark world, a very, very lost world. And the darker it gets, the more you will shine. And the closer you push in, the brighter you will shine. And the more you walk into dark rooms, they won't be dark anymore. And so when you look at your workplace and you say, I really don't like it here, it's dark. And I'll say, maybe God's placed you there to be the light. We read in Acts, don't turn there, but in the book of Acts, when God spoke to the people, when he poured out his spirit on the people, they began to preach and teach, and it was just like a raging river. The enemies of the gospel couldn't stop it. One theologian said it was like a bunch of ants, the bad guys trying to stop a raging river. It couldn't happen. When the gospel gets moving, it's moving. It's cutting through hearts. It's cutting through societies and communities and cultures. It doesn't care. It's the gospel of Jesus Christ, and it brings change. It said there that they added to the church daily. Now, the church isn't perfect, right? Because it's made up of a bunch of people. The church, by definition, is the greatest gathering of potential servants in the world, one guy said. The greatest potential gathering of servants in the world. Potential. That word comes up again. Now, we don't always get it right. We have failed. And I'll tell you right now, I will apologize right in this place in advance for the mistakes I make. I apologize now. So when you come to me and said, I'm going to go, I told you, I'm sorry. I'm just a guy. I'm under construction like you guys are, right? So if you're around me, you better wear a hard hat, because you might get a block dropped on your head. You don't know what's going on. God's changing me like he's changing all of us. But I'm ecstatic. I'm ecstatic that I'm a part of a church that is alive and mobile and on the move with momentum. We're going forward, church. We're reaching and shaping and loving this world, a church that has momentum. And a church with momentum does not have to worry about stagnation. Stagnation is just nasty, isn't it? Really, stagnation. I mean, Florida has a bunch of swamps. You know, there's a couple reasons I don't want to go to the swamps to swim. One is gators, right? The other, because it's just swampy. It's got filled. It seems like this film you just see on that. I don't want to swim in that. I want to swim in the river of life. You know what I mean? And when we start thinking about that, you don't have to worry about the spiritual bacteria when you're living in the raging rivers of the Lord. You know what I mean? You don't have to worry about things just sitting to the side and spiritual bacteria developing. You don't have to worry about that because it's fresh. It's fresh. And I wake up and his mercies are renewed every morning to me. Every morning I wake up and I take a breath and I say, man, God, let me check. Yeah, I'm still alive and you still got me. I feel your mercies again. And I'm going forward with the plan that you have for me today. You're not called, listen to this, you're not called to change the hearts of people. God does that work. The Bible tells us it's the goodness of God that brings people to repentance. It's not your awesome words. It's not your exposition. It's not how you break down scripture for people. Do we do that? Yes. Do we study? Yes. Do we believe like a child? Yes. In fact, we have this faith like a child, but we study like an adult. You know what I mean? Childlike faith, adult theology. Believe like a child, but study like you've got to get something done so that when people are hungry, and they are hungry, they might not know what they're hungry for. You don't worry about that. You worry about giving them Jesus. That's what they're hungry for. Turn over to Matthew 13 real quick, and then we're actually going to be in two places of Matthew 13. It's a very familiar passage of Scripture. I don't want to spend a whole lot of time here. I just want to bring something out to you. Matthew chapter 13, starting in verse 1, says that the same day Jesus went out of the house and he sat beside the sea. And great crowds gathered about him. So he got into the boat and he sat down, and the whole crowd stood on the beach. And he told them many things in the parables, saying, a sower went out to sow. And as he sowed, some seeds fell along the path, and the birds came and devoured them. That's one, right? He sowed them, and the birds got them. That's one. Verse 5 says, the other seeds fell on the rocky ground where they came, and they didn't have much soil, and immediately they sprang up, and since they had no depth of soil, but when the sun rose up, they were scorched. That's two, right? And since they had no roots, they withered away. Verse 7 says, the other seeds fell among thorns, and the thorns grew up and choked them out. And other seeds fell on good soil and produced grain, some hundredfold, some 60, some 30. He who has ears, let him hear. Now listen, there's four different things that are happening in there, and it looks like we've got a return of about 25% of those seeds thrown. That's what it looks like here, right? If you start doing math, I've heard theologians discuss this before. You've got about 25% of the stuff coming back that you throw. So if we're seed throwers, which we are, and some are waterers, and some go along and get to pick the harvest, but we're all seed throwers. That means you're sharing the gospel here and sharing the gospel here. You know what you need? You need a bigger pouch of seeds. You know what I mean? We have to throw more seed. LifePoint, come on, we have to throw more seed in this place. We start pushing it here, pushing it there, and say, well, that got choked out. Guess what? I've got more seed for that area. I'm not going to worry about it. Guess what? The thorny bushes came out and choked this one out. I'll throw some more seed there. The birds got it over here. I've got more seed for that area, too. It doesn't matter. I've got plenty of seed. The gospel is enough. It's never going to, you don't have to worry about it running out. There's always, always more of God to be had. Right? If he really is all-powerful, which he is, and he really is, he knows everything, if he really is all of these things, then there will always be more of him to have. And if we reach down there, like we talked about in the previous passages, you talk about the fullness of God. Go back to Ephesians chapter 3, verse 19, and to know the love of Christ that surpasses the knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. Your heart's here, right? And God wants to pour it and fill it up. And your heart can always receive more of God. And there's always more of God to go into your heart. It's a beautiful, beautiful thing. Receive it, people. God is doing something. And so we throw more seed. And I don't know how you do that. I don't know how you specifically throw your seed and how you share your gospel. But I would suggest that you start with your story about how Jesus has changed your life. I think that's a wonderful, wonderful place to start. The church is not just a crowd of transformed lives, but this transformation that happens inside of us that drives us out. We have to understand this. And the church functions within a couple of ways, maybe more, but for today's sake, it functions in a couple of ways. One is inside of these walls, and the other is outside of these walls. Some of you are the best of church attenders the world has ever seen. You're just here, you're just here, you're just here. Every time the doors are open, you're here, and that's wonderful. I applaud that. I love that about you. I feel the same way. I always have a drive to get to the house of God, right? But let me tell you, he's everywhere. And so we function inside of these walls, and then when we get lit up by the Lord, we walk outside of these walls, and we function as the church in there too. But I find it interesting that our ratio most of the time is spent outside of these walls, correct? You come here 2, 3, 4, 5 hours a week. Now, some of these guys have been in the buy a tree tent a lot of hours this week. So the ratio is a little more evened out. But most of your time is spent outside of these walls. That means you need to get busy sharing with people. Now listen to this. Some of you think that when you think about investments, you think about money or cars or real estate, right? And you start thinking about this. But listen to this. Scott Williams says, your best investments won't come in the stock market. They will be found in the people market. Invest in others. Everybody needs somebody here, 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 and here. You need somebody who's pulling you. You need to be pulling the people alongside of you, going forward together, and you need to have somebody behind you that you're pulling along. You grab the rope and you just walk. You walk, and that rope is attached to other people. Everybody needs to have this model. This is the model of discipleship. Ultimately, all the ropes lead to Jesus, right? And he's pulling, and he's pulling us towards him, but we have those people. I have the people above me in my life that I call and say, speak into me. Tell me something. Tell me how I'm missing it. Help me. And nobody likes to hear that stuff, right? Nobody likes to hear those corrective measures, but it's important to have those. And so we begin to invest in people. No, invest in the stock. I'm not telling you not to invest in the stock market. That's not what I'm saying. But I'm saying remember, people might remember what you tell them. They might remember things like that. They might even remember something you show them, a great example. But people will almost always remember how you make them feel. You hit them right in the feelings. It's called love, people. You love them. You just love them right where they're at. And once again, I'm in no way suggesting that the church attendance is not important. In fact, I think regular church attendance, being twice a week at least, is essential. And the local church is important for this, and it will help you with your marriages. There's people here who have been through marriage struggles, and God has healed them. God has restored them. So for you to come alongside and act like your marriage is perfect and keep going struggling all the way, that might not help you. But to get plugged in with somebody who can speak into your marriage and allow God to heal you in this process is something amazing. Some of you might struggle with addiction. I would say find somebody and open up to them, a trustworthy source of somebody who can help pull you out of that. And just friendships. How many of you just need friends? I'm talking about friends who will be there for you. Friends that will ask you the tough questions, right? See, what's going on here? Just like I said earlier, what's God telling you? What's God showing you? These are important, important things. And the church must be a couple of things. It must be noticeable. The church must be noticeable, both physically and spiritually. I remember the story of a guy who lived in an area. It was a small community, and the biggest church in the area was one of those very traditional-looking white buildings, and it had a nice big steeple up top with the cross, and he drove by that thing for 50 years. 50 years he drove that. He never had a desire to go in there, and all he lost everything one day. And he had driven by that place, and he had remember seeing all the people week by week that flocked into that place and flocked out of that place, and the lives of the people that he touched in the community. He didn't want anything to do with them, but that one day he said, I recognize that something is different inside of the people. I recognize something about them, that they're after something, and he was challenged with that, and he went in there as a place of recognition. And we got to be that church. We have to be noticeable, and we have to be available. We have to be available in this society. Many times, people just want you to listen, and we have trouble with that. We do. We have trouble with listening. We get so wrapped up in formulating thoughts on how we can speak into their lives. Sometimes just people just want you to look in their eyes and listen. Listen. If LPC was gone tomorrow, what would the community miss about this church? If LPC was gone tomorrow, what would the people say? Could they survive, or would they say, what are we gonna do? LPC's gone. Now make that personal. If you were gone tomorrow, what would they miss about you? Would they say, hey, he was the greatest tile layer I've ever seen? This guy could, he just had the most beautiful electrical work, or the best plumber in the world, or that guy could catch a fish out of anything. Those are all fine things, but one day, very, very soon, if the Lord tarries, they're going to put us in a box, and they're going to put us in the ground, and it's going to be all over. And I'll tell you right now, I could care less if I ever caught another fish again. Fish, scales, gills. But I'll tell you what, God has made us a fisher of men. And that is my desire. So when I get there one day, if the Lord tarries, if he doesn't come and get us very soon, then they put me in a box. I say, listen, I want people to stand up and say, this guy loved Jesus. This guy loved Jesus with every single breath inside of him. That's the goal, right? Just pointing people. Switch over to Matthew 16 real quick. I gotta hustle a little bit. Matthew 16. They had just arrived at the shore of Caesarea Philippi. We're picking up in verse 13. Matthew 16, 13. And Jesus asked his disciples, he said, who do people say that the Son of Man is? And they say, some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, others say Jeremiah, or one of the other prophets. And he said, but who do you say that I am? If you've been in church at all, you've heard this passage. Verse 16 says, Simon Peter replied, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus answered him, blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Then he strictly charged the disciples to tell no one that he was the Christ. We don't have to worry so much about building the church. We just do what we're supposed to do. Jesus is going to build his church. If we start living like we really believe this, you actually read it, you actually believe it, you actually tell other people about it, you quote it, you put it on paper, you put it on Facebook, you speak it out, you live it out. If we start doing that, Jesus will build his church. Because people are hungry. People are looking for something. They're living in the darkness. They're tired. They're weary. They don't even know it. You can see it in their eyes when you walk by me. They're just struggling. They're empty. You see it. You just look at them and say, man, I know the answer for that guy. I know the answer. His name is Jesus, and Jesus involves us in this mission, and you either accept it or you decline it. You accept the mission or you decline it. And the result of us being obedient is that God's kingdom is expanded, and we have systems here at LPC, and we're going to have those systems, but it's more important that we just show Jesus and Jesus' love. And coming to church is like a vitamin shot, right? It really is. I said it earlier. But guess what? Being the church is like giving a vitamin shot of Jesus. I just didn't come to get a vitamin shot, but I want to live in a way that's giving the vitamin shot of Jesus to people, just pushing it into them, directing it into their lives, injecting it into their heart, injecting it into this community. The harvest is great. When Jesus was teaching, he said, don't tell me that it's not ready. It's ready. The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. So look around where it is for you. Who can I touch? And sometimes it gets difficult, and we say, this is hard. It's hard. I don't think it's hard. I lived in a country for almost 4.5 years where this is illegal. It's illegal. And if they felt like it, they would start dragging people out and cracking heads with sticks. I lived there. My wife was born and raised there. This isn't hard. But sometimes we like to think it's hard. We think it's difficult. This is difficult, but it's really, we make it difficult. A.W. Tozer, one of my favorite writers, said this, Christianity is hard because we are trying to serve God in man's way instead of serving God in God's way. Oh, the whole time. We see over and over again in Scripture what Jesus is saying. What is he saying? Get it sorted out. You work it out. No, that's what I tell my daughter sometimes. Jesus doesn't say it. He said, listen, if your burden is heavy, You're tired, you're weary, you're worn out. What does he say? Come here. Come here. Come here. Come here, people. That's all Jesus is saying. That's what God wants you to do. He wants you to draw in so that he can just love on you right in this moment. And it's hard, it's difficult. Yeah, when we make it hard. And we love people, and you guys love, I know, love well, and it's challenging. And there may be people here who aren't followers of Christ yet. And maybe in your life there's people who aren't Christ followers yet. But if you keep working with them and you keep loving them, you keep showing them Jesus, something will happen. He will begin to work. And I just said it, but how are we going to reach this world? How are we going to reach this world, church? Love. Love. We've got shirts. There's 15, 20 people who are wearing love shirts in this place right now. Love. Love. You might have the shirts. You might even have it tattooed on your body somewhere. I don't know. But do you have it marked on your heart? We know that Jesus is never going to forget us. He bears the scars. There's something there. There's something there. And this crazy love that God has, it's changed us. And so when we think about that, we realize that that expectation begins to grow. And the momentum begins to grow. And it begins to swell inside of us. Mark Twain, the great theologian, said, apparently there is nothing that cannot happen today. I didn't follow Mark Twain, but I like that quote. There is nothing that can't happen today. If we still believe that he's the God of miracles, do we still believe that he changes hearts and changes lives? Some of you, it's been so far removed. Your moment of transformation, your moment of conversion was so distant, you almost forgot that. You almost forgot the intensity of a Savior who loves that much. Tell your story. Tell your story. Because people are dying to hear it. People are dying to hear it. And all this momentum and all this charge and the fact that we're in this moment and everything that's happened inside of our lives has brought us to this moment. But let me tell you something. We cannot accomplish what we are called to do without the blood of Jesus. We cannot accomplish what we're called to do without the blood of Jesus. Can't do it. And so today we just want to change things just a little bit. I know that that's going to mess with some of you. It's okay. It's okay. Just relax for a second. Because we take communion very seriously here. And you don't have to be a member of the church, but you do need to be a member of the body of Christ. This is important. It's imperative. It's not something that should be done out of habit, but out of complete reverence. And we're going to pray in just a moment before we do this. And things are going to, like I said, going to be a little bit different. But you know what? What's going to happen is the stations are going to look the same. But we've got individual cups and a wafer. Here's what I want you to do. In a moment, we're going to pray. We're going to do all that. But when you come get these elements, I want you to hold on to them. Just hold them. Take them back to your seat and let it stew. Just let it sit and begin to close your eyes and let God speak to your heart and begin to reflect about what went down to make this moment happen. Think about it. Don't forget to hold on to them. Just go back to your seat after you grab them and just wait. And we'll partake together. If you want to sit down for a couple of minutes, that's fine, and pray and talk to the Father. But right now, let's just bow our heads. Father, I just thank you so much. God, for your love, for your grace, for your mercy, so rich and free. God, we don't take this lightly. It has impacted our hearts so greatly. Maybe you're sitting here this morning and you've never connected with Jesus before. Maybe that's you this morning You say, I've got to get this right today. I can't walk out of this place the same way I came in. I've got to be different. I know Jesus can change me. If that's you, would you just slip up your hand this morning? Any hands? I see the hands. I see them. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, for changing hearts, for stirring us this morning. Thank you, Father, for your great love. Father, we thank you for the gift of your Son, Jesus. And if you raise your hand this morning, just pray this. Say, God, thank you. Thank you for shedding your blood for me. God, change my life today. Don't leave me the same. Be my Savior. Be the Lord of my life today and forever. I'm never the same after today. I'm going after you with everything that's inside of me. We love you all. We love you, Father. Thank you for this time. In Jesus' name, amen.